I'm going to start by saying a few words about HLB, because I think it, you say HLB, HLB, that's the Norwegian. HLB.no, that's where you find it on the internet. I'm going to say a few words about it because I think it's a very interesting institution in the context of what we are talking about in this group, because it's actually the only cooperative higher education institution, I think, in Europe. I don't know if you have them in America, but at least it's the only one in Europe. And we are owned by something like 120 different owners, farming unions, small farmers, village unions, small and medium-sized enterprises, regional and local development companies. And the institution was created, it's quite new, it opened in 2005, so we have a 10-year jubilee this year. But it was created because local people, farmers, and community people felt that we need higher education. Not that there isn't higher education from before, because of course there are quite a few other institutions in the different cities and towns in Norway, but we need higher education for rural people, for farmers and rural people, that is focusing on our needs, our knowledge needs. And it's a very welcoming. I'm the rector of HLB, and to lead such an institution, which is so unique, is really fantastic. But it's also we have a great responsibility because we have to answer this call. So we have also a slogan or a vision of, don't know what you can call it, but. Which we you see it when you log into our website, and that is knowledge for development, not knowledge about, but knowledge for. And that is the difference here, that there are so many academics, and we have our share in Norway, that just observe and describe from a distance. And that was the reason that HLB was created, that we need something else. We need an institution that go in there together with local people and produce knowledge that is applicable and useful in that particular situation. So that is our purpose, that is our mission, and that's what we try to do. And that is a very interesting way of seeing knowledge. Because knowledge, we all know, I mean, there's so much knowledge out there. You can twist and turn every situation, every challenge, every question by the knowledge in terms of what you pick, what you deem important, what you leave out. And we are very clear on what we do. We are in many ways pragmatists in the sense that we say that, okay, we are looking for that kind of knowledge. We are seeking that knowledge that can make a positive contribution in this situation here and now. And I think that is a major challenge for all academia in the years to come. And it's a major challenge if we are going to succeed with this aim of creating a more sustainable future. We as academians must follow up. And in that sense, I'm very grateful and proud to be here with you today and in this conference. I have a very pretentious title, you see, talking about democracy. But how did that come up? It's a very big word. People don't work with democracies anymore. I mean, they are there, you know. We take them for granted. So we have stopped kind of discussing the concept, what does it actually mean? And I discovered that after I've been working now with a rural empowerment community development for the past 20 years, and I've discovered that what I'm actually working with is democracy and the shortcomings of Western democracy in 2015. And how can we make it back better? How can we improve it if we're going to succeed with this great vision of ours of creating this sustainable civilization? I'm going to talk about that. The concept of empowerment. It's a fantastic word. Mobilization, something we have to do. If we're going to succeed, we have to involve people. And how do you involve people? How do you get people involved? And I'm not talking about only the people who are convinced on beforehand, but the others. How we involve them? Because if we don't involve them, we lose. Because the convinced ones are too few. So we need to be able to reach out to the others. Those who do not share our ideas. I have separated this talk in two parts. First, I'm going to sit down, and I was asked here if I'm a sitter or a stander. I'm very much a stander and walker. But first, I'm going to sit down and talk a bit about empowerment as a concept. How do we relate to it? What does it mean? And what are the challenges? And then I have some slides also, because in the second part of the talk, I'm going to scale up a bit and talk about how we can use this knowledge in mobilization and also renewal of democracy. I said empowerment is a fantastic word. Of course, it has to do with power. But it's not power over. Empowerment is that kind of potential that we all have to be active, to be actors in our own lives and in our communities. How do we define empowerment? We can try by saying what is it not? What do we think about when we think about empowerment? I'm a lot around in local communities in mostly in Norway, but also in other countries in Europe. I also work for the EU Commission on entrepreneurship. But I often meet people who stand here with their backs against the wall and saying that development has to run its course. There's nothing we can do to stop development. And that is a disempowered human being. He does not believe that his or her voice will be heard, or that anyone will listen, or that not anything that this person does can do anything to change anything. This is a disempowered human being. Then we're talking about distance. We're talking about alienation. We're talking about lack of self-efficacy. So what then is empowered? Is an empowered human being? I have, in 2007, I was working on a very, very big project. I wrote something in Norway. I don't know if you have the same system, but we have something called a Doctor Philos, which is different from a PhD, because Doctor Philos is one of these, when you've been working for quite a long time and you feel that you have kind of created some thoughts and now you want this to become something more, then you write 600 pages and you go to university and say, I want this as a doctorate. It's a very ancient system, and we still have it, and the Germans still have it. But very few people do it now, but it's like, because it's a very brick of a... but what I wrote about, actually, was something that fascinated me about our own country. Because Norway is a very, very affluent country. Oil, yeah. So we don't know what we'll do now. But up to now, it has been a very affluent country. We have, of course, the same challenges as many other countries when it comes to rural communities. We have the problem of out-migration. We have a vital countryside all over the country, but still that problem is there. We live in an urban age. People move to cities. So that is one of the challenges we need to work with. We always have focus on innovation, entrepreneurship. But the problem in Norway is not lack of jobs. There are many, many jobs, not necessarily the jobs entirely in the communities that entirely fits your interest, but there is a job. And still what's kind of started fascinating me was these people who really commit themselves, do something else. People who spend like 10, 20 years of their lives when they don't have to, spending all their money just because they want to create something new. They have water over their heads. Still, they go on. And I've been traveling the third world. I've been also doing a lot of work in the third world. I see a lot of creativity there. But there is easier to understand because you have to do it. If you don't do it, you starve. But that can't be the answer in Norway, because there are so many other jobs to choose from. So why do people still do it? So that was the thesis. It's called Man as Creator. And the whole project is about understanding what makes people create, and has a lot to do with empowerment. What I did was, first, I went through all these basic economic theories and had to throw them all away, because bottom line of all of them is that people do something because they want to make money. And these people didn't make money. So then again, I had to throw all those theories away. And then you have all these psychological theories, which are kind of, for an anthropologist, they are kind of, you have these tests. What do you see here? What do you... Okay, there might be something to them, but they didn't really appeal to me. And there is also danger there that many of these tests about testing people's creativity are, you can come out as highly creative, or you can come out as not creative at all, and then you can just go home and take it easy, because then no creativity is expected from you. But that, of course, in a rural community, that's absurd, because we need everybody involved. So that bunch of theories didn't appeal to me either. So then, of course, I turned to philosophy. And it's then I started first kind of feeling that I got the thread. I was at the conference, one of these rural innovation conferences that we have so many of, that some people from an institution called Innovation Norway, it's the institution with all their money, travel around and say that now rural people, you need to be innovative, that kind of conference. And this guy was sitting next to me, and I knew him well, and he was one of these really committed people. He had been working with his project, which was a farm-based project, farm-based innovation, for 15 years. And now he had been all through all these kind of downward spirals. He had water over his head for many years, spent all his money. And now he was starting to see the light. And he said to me, I don't think this person really know what this is about. And that was, again, became the question, what is this really? To make a long story short, Nietzsche is the great philosopher of innovation. He has the most precise definition of human being as creator that has ever been written, in my view. Nietzsche says that everybody thinks that the tree is preoccupied with the fruit, but the tree is preoccupied with the seed. And therein lies the difference between those who create and all those who merely consume. That's a fantastic definition. Between the seed and the fruit. I read the American philosopher Robert Persig, and his ideas about metaphysical quality, and his ideas about dynamic quality. Being in a quality situation, feeling that this is the right thing to do. I had opened something here, but I'll open it later. What is the dynamic quality? Dynamic quality is pure experience. It's experience that things are as they should be. The experience that you are in the middle of the world, at the edge of existence, vast emptiness and nothing sacred. If there ever was a visible concrete metaphor for dynamic quality, this was it. Where you can think freely, where you kind of feel liberated from all these should nots, do nots, could nots, must nots. A place to be alone and quiet and inconspicuous and able to settle down into himself and be what he really was and not what he was thought to be or supposed to be. When I went back to these people I was working with, because I had asked the same questions that they were used to being asked. What is your product? How much do you earn? How much have you spent? And they answered. But I saw that it wasn't, they answered, but it was more like automatic, that this wasn't what they really wanted to talk about. Well, then I went back to them and started to approach this in a different way and let them kind of lead the conversation. What this is really about, what are you doing? And they were talking about quality. They were talking about being in the center of the world. They were talking about the seed. They were all talking about the seed. About being at center stage, about the edge of existence, about bringing the world forwards. And that is also a very good sentence from Persig, who says that the most moral activity of all is the creation of space for life to move forward. So now we're talking about empowerment. Now we're talking about people who feel empowered. Empowerment has to do with proximity, being close, feeling connected, being in the middle of. This is existential question. We are also here talking about ontologies. How do you see your role in the world as a human being? Jean-Paul Sartre, he told us about our ability to choose. He told us about the difference between essence and existence. Where existence is the human condition that we have to choose. But they also told us about our ability to run from our ability to choose. And this is very much about, when we talk about this and what does this mean for in a rural community? I've been playing with two kind of opposite values or opposite choices, so to speak. And the one is being the creator of values, and the other is being created by them, and then by values that are not your own. As I said, we live in an urban age. We are dominated by urban values. When we sit down, we switch on the television, it's urbanization everywhere. And this is what our young are being fed. So how do we do? When we see, it's kind of interesting when you see what communities succeed and what communities do not succeed. And in almost all cases, it has to do with that choice. Because small communities are small communities. Small rural communities in an urban age, what does it take for them to succeed? More people must become active. More people must become creator of values. The more people who kind of stand with their back against the wall and said, there's nothing I can do, the less likely it is for this community to succeed. So that is what we see all the time in the communities that do succeed, because there are many communities that do succeed. There are a proportionally larger number of creators who have seen this, that they have kind of, they cannot stop, they have to stop running from their ability to choose. The first process philosopher, Heraclitus, he has kind of become pop again today. I mean, lots of people are talking about Heraclitus, which is great, of course. But the most used metaphor is this about the river. I'm not going to take that one, but he has Heraclitus. He reflected a lot on where does the new come from? How does the new come into the world? And he introduced this dichotomy of fire and ash. The new is the fire. It's the burning. We have an image in Norway. It's a Norwegian eldsjel, which means fire soul. I don't know if you have it in English, but it's a fire soul. It's a very dedicated, committed person who's standing in the middle of the world, who's burning. And if you have many fire souls in a community, something will change. But then again, the opposite of fire is ash. And we are social beings. Even in an individual age, we are social beings. And what we often forget is sometimes this can be very, very, very simple. We forget that we are social beings. So we have another saying that we're saying that fire souls burn out. And why do they burn out? Because it's this metaphor of fire. You can think about your stove in the chimney. I mean, if you don't put in more fuel, it burns out. So we forget to thank people, saying that if we meet the fire soul, thank you for what you're doing. What you're doing is great. In an individual age, we often forget these things. We don't see each other enough. I said I'm going to show some images. Yeah, I haven't really spent too much time. I'm going to scale up and show a bit on how we work with these quite challenging concepts. Um, starting with democracy. It is very, often it's quite useful to go back and see, what does it mean? What does democracy mean? And it means power to the people. So the way I read it, I can't read it in any other way than this. That the real democracy should breed empowerment. A real democracy should empower people to empower themselves. But then again, then we know that in so many countries, and I don't think Norway is an exception in any way there, this is not the situation. There are so many people who do not participate, who do not feel that their voice is heard, who do not feel that they will make any difference. So they do not participate. And if that situation continues, we can forget about anything about a sustainable ecological civilization. This is a core challenge that we need to address. We cannot succeed in creating an ecological civilization without people. And then we need to be able to talk to them, involve them. So this is a major challenge, I think, all over the world. Of course, there are many reasons. And I'm not pretending to know the full answer in any way. But at least we have, over the last few years now at Holbier, been working on this, what has become now a democracy project. It started out as a rural development project, a community empowerment project. But we have come up with three major challenges. And I'm gonna have a look at efficiency. That's the god of today. It's kind of interesting how this works, because and how this is interpreted. Because also in Norway, I mean, we have a very efficient public system. It does what it's supposed to do. It produces all these plans. The problem is that there are so many people now who plan for people without them being involved. And that's never a very good idea. We know how people react. We know how we all react when we feel that things are being kind of pushed down from above. And they say that the new system of this Western efficiency model is, of course, that each process has a separate budget. So for doing this particular plan, this particular community development plan, this particular urban development plan, you have this fixed amount of money. And the number of plans go up. So the proportion of money to each plan is relatively going down. So and then you have this question of output and impact. Because you cut down where you can cut down, and cutting down, you cut down on involvement. You don't have time to go out and sit down with people, talk, what do they want, drink coffee with people. That's you don't have time to do it. So you focus the money you have on producing the plan. So there is an output, a plan, but that plan has no impact because people haven't been involved in producing it. And this is happening all over. This is something we must address. Meritocracy. The people who know better. The growth of the experts. The experts march in on more and more arenas. One arena after the other, the experts march in. Politicians use these experts all the time. And then you can, from one hand, you can understand it because society is becoming more and more complicated. But they don't see the consequences. The consequences is that more and more people will stand here and say that, I don't know about anything about this anyway, so let's leave it to the experts. So it breeds disempowerment, it breeds alienation. And this is a word of kind of, it's the first time I use it in English, actually. But it's a word I came up with in a new book that I wrote that came up just before Christmas. I'm going to explain that afterwards, because I have a model that shows what I mean by sectatorship, but it has to do with undermining democracy. Can you understand what I'm saying with the word? Is that a word that gives meaning in English?
Not yet.
Not yet. Maybe. I'll come to it. So what do we do? The first one, first of these challenges, again. First of these challenges, how do we address it? We have to go in the complete different direction. I don't know how familiar you all. I know there has been a lot of work also in the States on participatory democracy and what it means. I'm not sure that there is a kind of a unified idea of what that concept means. But I think still it is a good concept. But because the core here is we need to establish more arenas where people can participate directly in the development and execution of processes that affect their own life and future. Directly. We have, in Norway, we have the hearings. And hearing, you go into a hearing as an interest group, and to be heard, you turn up your interest 200%, and all who do that do the same thing. And you get like 15 different kind of hearings that go in all directions, end up with nothing. They do not work. And then typically you have this information meeting where authorities come and inform. But you can see that their opinion is made up before they came. So it doesn't really make any difference if you come and join that meeting at all. But this is something else. If you're going to do participatory democracy, you need to give away power. You need to relinquish power because you need to put power into these arenas. People need to feel that there is a point of me being part. There is a point of me participating. Me participating will make a difference. And we know these things. We know them from our own lives, and we know them from research, that people will not take responsibility without being given responsibility. And we also know that people who experience being heard will continue participating. And vice versa, in the sense, if you participate and are not heard, the chances are that you will next day, either someone, anything, many other things you can do than turning up on this. So it's about responsibility breeds engagement, engagement breeds participation, and participation breeds sustainability. And why does it do that? Because ideas that we create together, of course, much more sustainable than ideas that are enforced by only a few. This, I'm not going to say so much about this, but we are part of an international organization which is called the Observatory on Participatory Democracy. And it's kind of interesting how you can deal with it. What is an effective local democracy? This is a model that OIDP has created. I don't know if you've seen it before. But participation is the key here. It's not only about local elections. What are elections? That is the way we have elections. That's what we are democratic. We have elections. So every second or third or fourth year, you go and you put the paper into a box, and then you leave the rest to others. This is something completely different. This is about real participation. Participation in budgeting. How do we use our money? Participation in planning. How do you want to, our community to look like? How do we want to develop this street? It's not something the experts should do. We should do it together. And we should also monitor and evaluate together. As a Norwegian, I'm not expecting you to understand this. But I'm this is from an article I had in a newspaper. This guy here, he led the expert commission on what we will live from in the future in Norway. And who is he to say that? People were not involved. They were all the people who kind of, they were all experts. This guy is an economy professor and he's looking. Now I'm coming to this sector thing. This is kind of interesting. It's something that we perhaps take for granted, but when you're looking into it, it's kind of interesting. Sectorization. Why is that the problem? The processes here are quite interesting. The sector comes from Latin, it comes from secare, it comes from splitting up, cutting loose. And it's something that we do when we come up, things are getting too complex. So we need to cut it into small parts to understand it. That's why we do it. So what happens, sectorization is a process. What happens, we start building our own arenas, where we meet our own. We start building our own languages that we can communicate with our own indicators of what success, measures, values. And we do it within the box. Problem here. There are many problems with this. I'm going to say a few words about it. Well, why does this link to democracy? This is a very big problem because some of these sectors are getting enormously powerful. More and more power are moved into here. And what happens then is that this is not democratic. These are not democratically elected. Power loses face. Politicians say that, no, I cannot deal with details. People here say, I'm only doing my job. So where did power go? What we discovered is that we're getting a society that looks like this. The verticalization of society. These silos, these are Norwegian, but it's the same that was on the last one. We're cutting and cutting and cutting. Every time we feel a complexity, we don't sit down to analyze it and putting the pieces together, we cut a new part loose. And we're talking more and more to our own and less together. So one problem, yes, power loses face, democracy is undermined. Second problem, can you see what the second problem is? We cannot solve our challenges with a society that looks like this. Because challenges, of course, are horizontal. But instead, we analyze the challenge on each arena, and they come up with completely different answers. We came up with this challenge. Also, we're working on a very very challenging project actually on soil conservation in our region in Norway. As I said yesterday, this is both the most important agricultural region in the country, but it's also characterized by rapid population increase. It's a small area. It's a lowland plateau. It's very fertile. It was made by the ice. Very, very fertile land. And it's near the sea, nice beaches, a very, very popular place to stay. And also you have like 600,000, which is for us, it's a big number, 600,000 people hiking in the region. In Norway, that's a big number. And then you have it's a region that is very, very, we have lots of cultural heritage objects, many old graves, because it was also the first part of the country that was populated. There's a lot of natural heritage there, high biodiversity because of farming, not despite it, as some environmentalists claim, but it's because of farming, actually. So we were working with this idea of, because we have over the last decades lost a lot of soil. And that's soil is lost to development. We started working with this, and we came up with this analysis. What we found was that farmers and soil conservationists, they were here. They had their own arena. They were singing songs. And every gathering was a kind of a jubilee because everybody agreed. So we kind of were singing some every and that was the same. The environmentalists, they were meeting on their own arena, only talking to their own. The developers, they had their own conferences, speaking their own language to themselves, etc., etc. And of course, what happens then is that because there is no common currency between these, so you have to go to the currency that is common, which is money. And when money is on the table, soil loses. Farmers can't compete. So we saw that we have to think totally in a different way. We cannot continue with this system. So we had a lot of publicity on the project because we had a lot of results, etc. And I had this very, very interesting phone call. A very surprising phone call, because we are also, in a sense, we as an institution, we are part of a rural Norway, part of farming. We are also belong, we have these stereotypes, because what happens here is that all your ideas also, this is actually conflict dynamics we're talking about here, folks, because all the ideas about the others are created only by talking with your own. So we also had these stereotypes about these developers. So what happened is I got this phone call from this guy, and he presented himself as actually the director of the biggest development company in the region, actually in Norway. And he said, we've heard that about this project of yours, and we have been kind of, the image of us is of the big bad wolf. But we do not like to build on agricultural soil. But we do not have any dialogue with farmers. Can you help us? So what did we do? What we did was that then we came up with this idea. But what about what we saw also? This is what we saw, but this is also, as I said, in a description of society, because we have lost the horizontal arenas. They are not there anymore. So we have to recreate them. So then I went from group to group and invited them more or less, come up of the trenches and join us in creating something completely new. Let's try to do what you are doing now within each of these silos. Let's try to do it together. Let's sit down across all these divides and see if we what would be our common language. What would be our common values? What would be our common arena? And what would be our common indicators of success? So we created this. In Norwegian, it has this name Jærsmia, which is Jæren is the region, which is like Jærsmitti, more or less would be in English. It's a dialogue forum, yes, but it's also a kind of a think tank in a very new way, because think tanks also have a tendency to be ideological. This is another kind of think tank. We are using dialogue. Dialogue is the opposite of discussion. That's also something that we often forget, because discussion is very simple. I mean, you have your ideas, and in discussion, it's a zero-sum game. When you win, the other lose. We saw that that was the climate. This was a climate of discussion. And it was a stalemate. Nobody ever loses a discussion, in a sense, because you can win the one day, but the opponent will still be there. The next day, continue what he's doing. And this has been kind of a very, very interesting project, in the sense that it kind of twisted around with all the ideas I had about who the others are. What happened here that these land developers, nobody had ever invited them to reflect on soil protection. Nobody had ever invited them to create a strategy on soil protection. Nobody had ever invited them to take ownership of the concept soil protection. We had just taken for granted that they are against soil protection, and all they want to do is to build as much agricultural land as possible. This project also created a lot of attention. I'm traveling now all over Norway to tell about it, and many other regions want to do some of the same. We call this the strategy dialogue-based development. And it's a very clear experience thus far. It increases participation definitely, and it does strengthen democracy because it alleviates the shortcomings of the representative system. And what are these shortcomings? The main shortcoming is that it is about participation again. But because we are more or less, we are used to others doing it for us, in a sense. But many of the challenges that we face cannot be solved if we're not involved, each and every one of us. There are two essential steps when you're working with these things. You need a proper stakeholder analysis. That also relates to what I said about the shortcomings of the efficient administrative system, because they never have time for a proper stakeholder analysis. Who are the actors here? Who is this about? And you need to involve them and give them ownership. There is a tendency that some about the concept of ownership is extremely important in this, in the sense that these projects, these processes need to be collectively owned. People need to feel that they own the process. They are a participant. Not only contributing, but they are participating. Of course, as I've written below there, that if you don't do this, you would just experience that it'll end up in a stalemate. Because people who are not invited in, people in groups who are not invited in, they may thwart to have the whole process. Start working against it, and it will stop. After like 25 years of mobilization, I'm dared to come up with a golden rule. But I think this is more or less, it works in all, both the golden one and the opposite. This is the key to succeeding with mobilization, that people must have a sense of ownership, must feel that this is about me. And that is a very big challenge when you're starting these processes. If you don't succeed here, you won't succeed with what you're trying to do. Yeah, a couple of images. This is from one of our gatherings. This is Järsmia, it's the name of that. We have, the interesting thing about Järsmia is that this is a regional development project. This is a project that started out as a very small idea in a small community. It would have now turned out to involve a whole region of 500,000-600,000 people. And there's so many involved on so many levels. Both private and public actors, interest groups. And here we are working. When we have these sessions, we are very focused on that people, when they sign up for one of these sessions, you need to also kind of, who are you? Where do you come from? What is your interest? Are you a developer? Are you a farmer? Are you a conservationist? And we make sure that on all tables, these are mixed. Private and public actors, business people. In Järsmia itself, it has a core group, which is kind of trying to be kind of representative. We had a very big challenge because this is something new. So we need to be a little bit undemocratic in the start because we needed to pick people that actually we knew that others would listen to. So we have some of the most important people in the region, in the Järsmia itself. It's a smaller group, but this is for everybody. We have quite a few of these open events. But we have the same major idea that we mix. This is about challenging each other. This is about co-creation across sectors, across interest groups, taking common ownership. When you this particular night here, the soil protection was what we were working with. This is Norwegian. I'm just showing this because this is a principle of the declaration made from Järsmia and from this collective gathering, and it says here. That yes, we can both serve our soil and build for a growing population. How can we do it? And there are many wise things here, but the main thing, the main message here is that this one is not, this is something we have done together. This declaration of principles is made by land developers, farmers, politicians, from left to right, environmentalists. They've all been involved. They all own it. They all have responsibility for it. And that's why also it's very sustainable. We're now seeing what this has done to soil protection in the region. A few things in the end here. I'm going to land, but I have a few examples on which I think. Because this is a regional development project. I'm going to say a few things about smaller projects and go a bit back to where I started about empowerment and how important it really is. This model that I'm talking to you about now has been in under development for like 15, 20 years. What we do, what is extremely important is that if you're going to succeed in developing a community, you must also recognize the diversity in that community. You may have very clear ideas about how things should be, what is sustainable, what is not sustainable. But you go on about kind of hammering those ideas in, you will not succeed. Parallel thinking, De Bono, perspectivism, Nietzsche. What does perspectivism mean? It means that now looking at this one here, I can only see my side of it. If I want to see the whole cup, I need all your eyes as well. Perspectivism means that a new eye adds meaning. The more eyes that are involved from different perspectives, the more meaningful, the more exciting. Parallel thinking, what does that mean? De Bono illustrates this very simply by some lines, ideas. Instead of using all our resources to hammer on others' ideas, others' values, why don't we just leave them? Leave them. And use our resources instead on our own. There's so many. If you work like that, kind of involving people, allowing people to be who they are, so much more can be achieved. Diversity, yes. Diversity is not a problem, it's a resource. And we have a tendency to kind of limit diversity. We like diversity when it comes to products. We like local foods. But it's more challenging when it comes to values. There is and you go around these communal meetings, they have a certain dynamics, kind of interesting, because we are often invited in, I'm often invited in to speak at these communal gatherings, and it's often kind of, the starting point is that a community, a place, has seen that now things are going bad. People are moving out, shops are closing, we need to do something. So we invite in for this communal meeting, and I said they have a certain kind of dynamics which you often see, is that people are kind of, you can read a lot from how people seat, for example. There is a group on the front, the first bench, who are they? Often youth, often women. They are the ones who say, come up with these, I have these new ideas, I have these brilliant new ideas, they're very, very active. And then you have another group, which kind of have a tendency to gather in the back, pretty close to the door, and they are not young, and they are not women. And they are the ones who, when one of these young women stand up and tell about the new idea, they are ones who say, oh, that is not realistic, I don't know, believe in that. That's that group. You can illustrate this with a line here. And this is kind of a fence. Let's say that this is a fence. And you have a few who are already innovators. And you have a group, more, but not necessarily too many more, that they are the keepers of the established truths. They have no interest in change, because they have the interest because they are that things should remain as they are. And the rest, of course, they are here. They're on the fence. They are the majority. They are kind of seeing the power battle between these two groups and what happens, and then they decide. This analysis here, it's very, very easy to kind of end up aligning with these. Because you, as a private, starting a process, you want something to change. These are the change makers. You want to align with them. But what you're forgetting, if you do that, you get some really powerful enemies, because they are the keepers of the established truth. They are the gatekeepers, and they can stop the whole process. So what you have to do there is something very, very similar between these two groups, which is very easy to forget. These two groups on both sides of the fence, they share one common value. They are very much engaged in their place. So that should be the resource. That should be the value that we work from, that common value that we work from. Instead of separating them, we need to come up with a model that is broad enough to include them, give them a role. This model here, I'm going to stop. This model here is quite complicated. This is the model I've been working with for, the first time I used that model is like 15 years ago. And it has been kind of used, and this is, and it's working actually. You recognize this Nietzschean seed fruit. The whole idea of this model, as you see, has two sides. We have a tendency now, when we're working, we have a tendency to focus, like Nietzsche said, like consumers, we are mainly focusing on fruit. We are focusing on the finished products. We are focusing on goods, services, etc. But we are also forgetting a wisdom that has been there as long as people have been farming. You cannot harvest without sowing. So, what are the seeds in a community? This model is filled with concepts and examples from a particular project that we did in this community, local community here in Sognefjorden. But there are so many values. These are the seeds. We have a high biodiversity. We have an environmentally friendly production. We have great nature qualities. We have histories that we can build on. We have some really strong regional core symbols. We have a very broad, tangible and intangible cultural heritage. We have a modern popular culture. We have a high quality of life. We have a lot of tacit knowledge. We have personal experience that connects us to the land. And that goes for everybody. If you start working, we should start working on the seed. If you focus on the seed and get people involved in kind of producing and reproducing, you see the landscape as an innovation commons. This is a kind of, what we're talking about here is a commons that has the opposite development trajectory of what we call, I don't know if you're familiar with the concept, the tragedy of the commons. So that, of course, we're talking about the tragedy of the commons, that is a commons that is being used up. This is the opposite. This commons will disappear if it's not being used. Here, the grass grows longer the more the cow eats, so to speak. So if you can get people involved, giving them role, who are the actors? What are your interests? How can you work? The clue is here to get everybody, more or less, as many people as possible, with their own interest, to be working with, have their eyes fixed on the local, but do it your way, exactly as you. Link it with your own projects. We are also learning, stealing ideas from internet, from the internet. How are these common programs, how are they, these common open programs, why is it that people sit around the world and spend so many, many hours working on these open programs without being paid? They do it because, of course, they're part of a community, but they also do it because they want to improve the programs for their own projects. So have no predefinition here. There is one particular community that I've grown extremely fond of. And it's a very, very fantastic story of what man can do. It's a very, very, very small community up north. It's the periphery of the periphery. And they came together in the same way. They saw that all the arrows were pointing down. And critically, actually, because this is a very, very small community, when 3-4 families go, I mean, a lot of the vitality is lost. So we sat down with them, started working. First, we did a kind of a linguistic. We were playing a bit with words first, because we have. This was a place that had been now become known as a place of out-migration. So we shifted out with in and said that what will have to change for this place to become a place of in-migration? And we saw that the stories would change, would have to change. The way we related to each other would have to change. We'd have to come up with something, some completely new ideas about what our resources are. So they came up with this fantastic vision. First, they did an inventory of resources like this. And there is a trick, because 99% of all communities in Norway, on the top of the list will be great nature. And that's true, because we have great nature all over, actually. But since 99% do it, it's not particularly exclusive. They didn't go into that trap. They came up with something quite different as number one resource in that community. And that was actually, on top of the list, was the ability to see each other. The ability to see each other, that was the top of the list. And they came up with a vision and a way of working that said, we will receive every person that comes here in a way that makes him or her wanting to stay. And that's what they did. And in this age of mobility, that was the right button. So many people move. We are on the move. We're moving. We're looking for something. What are we looking for? What is it that we are looking for? And they said that we believe that many people are looking for a place there where others will see you, where you are involved, where you are welcomed get a real welcome. A few years after, we had the first. This is kind of a periphery of the periphery. So we had the first Norwegian seminar for the periphery of the periphery in this place. That same year, this community got the in-migration prize, the rural development prize, for Norway, for their work. And in that seminar, we met some of the people who had come there to stay. And we learn what have they actually done? They have valorized diversity. These were people who were the first who came and stood before the audience. He had been living a rather tough life on the street in Oslo, kind of abandoned. He had moved up there, been welcomed, been allowed to. They were using this model. We want you, with your abilities, to look who are we, what is our place. And he had started a film studio. The other who came up was part of the same, this mobility, this international mobility. This was a guy from Germany, family from Germany. It's one of these global stories. He had started out as he owned a huge company all over Germany. Very, very busy businessman. And at some point he faced a crisis. His health couldn't take it. And the family decided to break every bond and do something else. And then you have this global story that goes via For 2 years, they were walking in the Himalayas. And then when we meet him, they're running a dairy farm in this particular little small place in northern Norway. They told the same thing. And all these different stories from Norway, from all over the world, actually. And the stories were very, very different, but there was one similar. The one similarity to all of them, that I was accepted for who I am. And I was allowed to use my ideas, what I'm engaged in. I was allowed to become a fire soul on my own terms. And I was also allowed to burn, and I was recognized. I was given fuel. And this is a place that is so far out. It had a very, very bad dirt road full of holes. But they said, we want a new road, but this is not the most important thing. Let's build a community first. Because if we have a common community, if we stand together, it would be much, much easier for us to stand up against the politicians and ask for a new road. And which was what they did. And this is about thinking like this, about focusing on the seed, about involving people, about creating arenas, about thinking horizontally. We have this idea of diversity today. We kind of recognize it, but we see in many communities. Why is it that people, because many people are moving in, but also many people are moving out. And many of the in-movers move out very quickly, which has not happened here, but happens in many communities. Why is that? It's because there is this underlying idea that you have to adapt. We say that, yeah, we recognize you for who you are, but there's this underlying set of established truths that are not necessarily said, but you need to adapt to them to be accepted. And they are not you. And then you move. Thank you.
A very difficult thing, which was truly make inside themselves the desire to accept other people who are different, because most people don't really want to do that. I mean, how did that happen?
In this particular case, I think they actually were right when they said that was a major resource in that community, the ability to see and accept.
People already were.
Yeah, like, yeah. I think so. And again, it was a very, very correct button to... it's fascinating to come up there now and see. I mean, it's a very international, very vibrant community.
What's the name?
Finnøy.
How do you spell it?
F-I-N-N-Ø. Yeah. That's the Scandinavian Ø. E-Y. Finnøy.
And how many people would you say lived in that town?
It's not a town really. It's a village. It's still very small, but they were down to like 15, 20 people. Now they're like 60, 70, I think, maybe more. All the abandoned farms have kind of started up again. There were three dairies that were kind of shut down. They're no all. One is run by this German family. One is run by a family from Lithuania, and one is run by a Norwegian family. It's kind of, It has to do with human beings and who we are.
I've been through all of this pondering how to deal with what's happening in rural communities in America, where it's hard for new farmers to begin because of the cost, and how to rebuild rural communities in face of the whole phenomenon of what we call heavy business, which is just working like a steamroll. You've laid out for us an awesome challenge. The strategies are very helpful. And I'm just struggling right now with how concerned people in rural America can address some of these issues where the power systems have changed so rapidly. So I like the approach here, but I'm trying to figure out where, as we talk about a different future, and we've got to resettle rural communities, and as Wes Jackson said, we have to get more eyeballs per acre back on the land. The challenge we have in face of the trends in the agribusiness industry, and I'm thinking of my friends in China, where a government policy now is to empty the rural areas and put everybody in the city and move in with an industrial model of agriculture. These strategies are good, but I'm just trying to deal with them in relation to these realities. The Chinese are facing an awesome problem.
Yeah, I want to say something about China. There's a big debate right now in China. One part is saying we need to stop here because right now it's a 50% urbanization rate. So this is a good balance. We should stop there. Try to work different models. One is for rural area, another one is for urban, like Shanghai, Beijing City. So that's one a group of scholars and entrepreneurs and the policymen try to argue for. But there's another right side. They say 50% is not enough. We need to continue to go to 70, 80. That's the model we should go. So it's huge for them. I appreciate the professor's talk about it. Because I come from Michigan. For last year, a group of those, like a social entrepreneur work in one city in Michigan. It's just nearby Ann Arbor. So Ann Arbor, we call Ann Arbor, it's like Manhattan. And our city, Ipsy, like Brooklyn. Yeah, so it's a total different world. So we try to work with the community. Ipsy, only like 20K population. But it's a high, really high poverty rate. It's like 25% poverty rate in that city. So we spend 1 year just walk into the city, just talk to different people. Don't do anything, just talk, just dialogue. Keep dialogue, keep find what their perspective are. So I just want to appreciate professor talking about really take time. A lot of professionals don't want to take that time, just walk, just talk. We try to do different, try to walk into the community and talk to different group people. But I think that's the right way. My model to build a development community. A couple of things I want to mention is I have been trying to work with the new economy movement in the United States. So we translate the 15 articles of new economy movement to Chinese to share with the people in China. Say in the United States, we are in the post-industrial society transition. We already come back to community. To find the right model for people come together to do the new economy model in local. But while China tried to keep going to 90%, 80 or 90% urbanization, we should be very cautious here to look at what's going on in the United States. Yeah, the model keep developing here. So we should can be very smart to do something different when we are in the 50% urbanization rate. Yeah, if we can do something different, we'll be back to that posture. So that's why we try to do something to bridge the ideas. So that's why I want to share. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
training community people to do this? I mean, in your institute or your university, you have workshops for community leaders to come in and learn what you're showing us here and then go back to the communities? Is that how the model works that way?
Yeah, I mean, empowerment is at the heart of everything we do, all our educational program also, because we see that that is the real key. Between the active, the active and the passive has to do with empowered, disempowered. A person, a human being who feels empowered can more or less move mountains. That's this example from Finnai also. That's what it's really about, because people that they, people who came in there were being empowered. They were allowed to be empowered, to stand in the middle of the stage, to be at part of the edge of existence, so to speak. And then that's also why they came overcame all these structural challenges, because they are there. This is a very tiny community in a very, very tiny and a very, very peripheral area. So they would never have been able to do that without focusing on empowerment. But we have a tendency to focus on structure first. And focusing on structure can be extremely disempowering, actually.
So how do you move communities from focusing on structure, focusing on the lack of resources, focusing on the problems rather than focusing on recognizing their special assets, the fact that perhaps friendship is worth more than a government grant. So how do you sort of move and facilitate those discussions so they don't get bogged down in, we don't have any money, the road's full of holes?
It's a very good question. I'm thinking about the experiences I have. I think in more or less all of them, this is something that started locally. And I think that this is it's a local idea. I don't think it works to come in from the outside and say you have to think differently. We have so many. It's kind of interesting. We have the people tell stories about how the communities are like, because we have from this Finnai, and other communities that have been very successful because people are involved and a large percentage of the population are involved. And we have communities which are doing very badly, and where people kind of explain how will you describe your community, and they use images like it's like me having to hide behind here, and every time I glance up, I fear the guillotine will cut my head off. So these are actually cultural constructions. These are human values, human constructions. That's what we're talking about. Yeah.
Several things. One is, I've heard now all of a sudden people talk about asset-based community development, but I think that's a gimmick. Unless there is what seems to be in your story is the discovery and then the valuing of the fire souls. And so if you're coming from the outside, it seems to me then your goal is to look for the fire souls and again, to follow your model, not just in one track. I mean, to sort of look at the fire souls that scare you as well as the ones that make you feel good. And I'm wondering to what extent that model works in China. That's some kind of a model that looks at the individuals in a community, and whatever you define a community, you really look for the individuals who are on fire, and somehow they get supported. I mean, is that a story that you've seen in China?
In China, in the village, right now, because the farmers has a high percentage income come from a migration job. So like 80-90% income is from the last city. So that makes it very difficult to or engage the adults for the community revitalization. So you can see a lot of village in China right now is only elderly people and very young kids. Yeah, so the young people is all gone to city. So we don't know what will happen because next generation, the young kids, they didn't like their father. Their father is initially poor, so they work very hard. But for this new generation, young kids, they already have family wealth to support them. So they don't want to work so hard like their parents do. So we'll see some dynamic change in China. So what can will happen? But I think some professor here, they have been working a lot of new projects. They try to build a local culture for villages to engage individuals. Like young students, when they graduate, they move to the villages to help do the cultural events. Yeah, a lot of events. But the economic power is so strong. Because the income, 80%, 90% comes from city. So it's hard to change that dynamic for young students go to the villages to make that change. So we hope the public policy in the top will kind of adapt some kind of new model. So that's why I try to work in Michigan to see the post-industrial model will like, that I will make a convincing power to the public policy sector. So come to look at Michigan, this model. This is already function. The people work well in the community. They can create a local wealth. If we have that model, like the Norwegian have that model, we can bring that model to China policy circle, so they can see this is maybe we should try, we should experiment that. So that's what I want to share. We have a professor come from Zhou. He's the professor from the National School of Public Administration. Yeah, they train a lot of public officials in China. Yeah, Zhou 老师. Professor Zhang is one major responsibility to educate the officials. So he's here, so he knows very well about China rule.
Well, I'm frustrated on two counts. Number one, we have to stop because 7 o'clock we start up again. And I'm frustrated that somehow our schedules got reversed because our first presentation was going to be a discussion of what's happening in China around rural empowerment, and somehow something went wrong and their schedule got changed. So with that frustration, I'll close on a positive note. Simply saying, Dag, thank you. It's been very helpful as we think about it here in the United States. But it's a global question of how we can rebuild rural communities, and without strong rural communities and a strong rural population, will never get close to the concept of a regenerative and therefore sustainable agriculture. It just can't happen. We've got to get a lot of people back on the land in strong, supporting rural communities. And what you're talking about is one of the basic challenges we're facing. The strategies that you outlined are very helpful. And I wish we had more time to hear what's happening in China, but we ran out. But thank you. Yeah. Very much.